Yeah, and I remember, it's a funny, you might want to roll this. You know, we did so many things with Santana, and we played a gig, I think, in Oakland at the Broadway or something like that in Jack London Square, which is near Yoshi's, right up the street. Somebody from Santana calls and says, can you guys come over and do a session after your gig tonight? We have a song we'd like you to play on. And the irony of this is that the same studio we recorded with Huey, the Automat in San Francisco. Yeah. So we figure, yeah, well, shit, Santana session, yeah, we're there. I mean, even if it's 2:30 in the morning, we'll be there. So we load up, go over the bridge, go in the studio, and they play me the track. And once again, I go to the desk in the front, where the management is, the station, studio manager is, which was, at that time was Michelle Zarin, I think. I'm not sure, maybe not. Michelle Zarin, she used to manage Tower of Power later, and she's a dear friend. And anyway, she used to manage Record Plant Sausalito, Record Plant here, and Automat. Anyway, we ended up doing this song. It was a song called Everybody's Everything. And it's probably been played by more marching bands at halftime on the football field. They took my arrangement. Somebody took my arrangement and made that Santana song. It's got the signature horn line. It's easy to play. So marching bands all over the United States adapted it, and it still gets played. I mean, still to this day, this is almost 50 years ago. Anyway, you know, we went through all kinds of stuff, and Carlos is always such a nice guy, and real good to us. You know, he really liked Tower of Power, and so he was very good for the band. We toured quite a bit with him. We got our name on the map. When you're the opener, the headliner does their sound check and sets all their gear up, you know, and then the opener gets to set up in front of them, and you can't strike anything of theirs. And you're usually at the edge of the stage because they're taking up 90% of the stage. You know, they pull back, you know, if the organ was on a riser on wheels, they'd pull it back and pull back maybe Chipito's percussion, and so we could really have a setup. You know, they were generous to, so we could present ourselves the way we needed to present ourselves, not just be the opener. And because they were very generous in that. So, you know, there's nice people in this business, and there's not so nice people, but they're the good guys. Of course, Neil Schon was in Santana, and then we went on to play with Journey, do a couple of songs on Journey Records. But Santana, Carlos is always such a nice guy. I did a solo record with Carlos called Light of Life. No, was it? That was the name of the song. It was a string arrangement. And we did it in New York City. And I think the album is called Welcome, that's right. And we had Leon Thomas, a famous jazz singer, sing on this one cut. It was strings, and he wanted me to write an intro a cappella before the track even started. And Carlos is always very colorful and picturesque in describing things. And so he says, I want you to write me the sound of a rose opening. Okay, you know. So I wrote what I thought would be the sound of a rose opening, if there is such a thing. Of course, there isn't. Anyway, he loved it. Yeah, it is pretty cool. I have a gold record for that. So at one point, I think, after sound check, before opening night, I was walking behind the curtain, behind the stage, and I see Carlos coming towards me. And he's with my Carlos Davis. And so, because Carlos was getting into the more jazzy kind of stuff, and you know, it was always Latin rock, but he was, you know, he's getting into that kind of, yeah, that's a good word for it. And so, we're approaching it, each other, walking right towards each other. I'm going this way, and they're coming this way. And Carlos says, we get right in front of each other, and he says, "Hey, Greg, meet Miles Davis." And I put out my hand, and Miles goes like this. And just walks by, and I'm like standing there with my hand out, like to shake Miles Davis' hand. So that was my one and only time meeting Miles Davis. Although we went on tour with him, not play with him, but open for him in Nice, France at the Nice Jazz Festival. But anyway, you know, the guys in Santana were, God, they were huge. They were just the biggest bands ever, you know, in the day. And they, everything in San Francisco was so, it was San Francisco, you know, I mean, it's San Francisco. The trends that were being set there, like I remember when Carlos was this shoemaker on Broadway, it was called the Rainbow Cobblers. It's right down the street, right up the street from Don Weir's Music City, where everybody bought their gear. I mean, everybody. It was the place to be, you know, it was like Guitar Center, only it was only one of them, you know, it wasn't a chain. So, I remember Carlos showed up somewhere with these calico patchwork high-heeled boots with little platforms, and all of a sudden everybody was buying these style boots from the same little old Italian shoemaker, and this is in North Beach, which is the Italian section of the city, and you know, and they weren't cheap, maybe $175 to $250 for a pair of boots. That was a lot of money then. Between that and a leather company called North Beach Leathers, between Carlos and the boots and Carlos and the North Beach Leathers, he kind of started to put them on the map. Everybody had them. You gotta get it. You gotta get the North Beach leather jacket. You gotta get the boots. So eventually I succumbed to that. And I remember I liked the jacket that I got, but the shoes are the most uncomfortable pair of shoes I'd ever worn in my life. I wore them once, and they were back of the closet. I never wore them again. They were just horribly made. I don't know, I must have gotten the guy on a bad day or something, but man, it just, oh God, that was $175 wasted, you know, but anyway, we had a lot of fond memories with Santana. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.